that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are.
Because of what I've done, but because of Will exalt The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome to Christ Church Brebden on this first day of August, the 10th Sunday after Pentecost. Welcome one and all, especially those who are visitors among us this morning. Let's begin as we say together the Collect for Purity. Let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to church. You know, we're in a playground, and sometimes when you're in the playground after you've been playing, you think ice cream. So let's talk about ice cream. My favorite, sort of kind of like this, chocolate. Now some people like vanilla or strawberry or a mixture. Ice cream is so good. Have you ever actually made ice cream yourself? It's not easy. Lots of work goes into it. You know, you have to have the salt and the cream and you have to churn it and ice. Very complicated. If you're like me, I go to the store and buy my ice cream. Now, one of the things about ice cream is that it melts. It doesn't last very long. And so it's one of the foods that we love, but it doesn't last. It melts and goes away. In the scriptures, we hear Jesus talk about the food for life, and that's spiritual food. So that by believing and loving God, we are fed the food for life through Jesus. And that's the bread of life. That's what we hear about in church. And we talk about in communion, being fed, our spirits being fed. Now, Jesus doesn't say that, you know, you don't enjoy the ice cream or other food that feeds us so that we can live. But he does say that we need the spiritual food to thrive or grow and to be loved by God. That's the spiritual food. The scriptures actually say, do not work for food which perishes, but for the food which remains to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. God's encouraging us. Seek out Jesus. Seek out the bread of life. Seek out spiritual food. Because unlike this melting ice cream cone, it is food that lasts forever. Let's pray. Dearest God, we thank you. We thank you for delicious food. We thank you for ice cream that feeds our bodies. But thank you for Jesus, who brings us spiritual food, a food that lasts forever. Help us to seek that food. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son, Jesus Christ, fed the hungry with the bread of his life and the word of his kingdom. Renew your people with your heavenly grace, and in all our weakness, sustain us by your true and living bread, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The reading is from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 to 16. Unity in the body of Christ. As a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he led captives in his train and gave gifts to them. What does he ascended mean? Expect that he also descended to the lower earthly regions. He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for work of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining in the whole measure of the fulfillment of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Thanks to be God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, where did you come from?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing?" Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Then Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, sir, give us this bread for all forever. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have you heard? There is a man who just the other day fed 5,000 people with just a few loaves and fish. And if you believe rumor, has even walked on water. There is a flurry of activity as boats of all different shapes and sizes arrive in Tiberias, everyone looking for this mysterious man who holds such promise and mystery. Nope, he's not here anymore, say the townsfolk with a shrugging of their shoulders and a lifting up of their hands. This results in a frenzied scene, like an ancient version of the Amazing Race, as people scramble back into their boats, tearing across to the other side of the sea to Capernaum. Well, not exactly tearing across. It was a 2 hours sailing time. They finally find him, everyone full of questions. The one burning question that makes it into today's passage from John's Gospel is, what must we do to perform the works of God? These simple people are trying to sort out how they might get on the good side of God. The best way to win God's favor is the question of the day. Surely this man of mystery and wonder must know. And what they want are how-tos and a formula for spiritual success. Instead, this man Jesus offers himself as the sustainer of life. It is not received very well. Did you expect anything different? Why is Jesus hardly ever received well? Some things never change. What never changes is the human condition to which we are all bound. We dress it up, we deflect, we overcompensate. But what lurks behind all of that deflection and overcompensating and dressing up is that to which we are bound, the belief that we aren't really worth being sustained. This deep sense of unworthiness before the eyes of God can be traced all the way back to one of the oldest Judeo-Christian stories, that of Adam and Eve. Deep within is a doubt that we can ever be truly loved by God, at least without us doing something, at least. To hide this sense of unworthiness, we align ourselves with anything and everything that validates us, either acts to please God, or a negation of even the existence of God, instead fashioning ourselves as God. We align ourselves with those who believe what we believe, and we become distrustful of others who may see things differently. It's into this human condition that Jesus speaks. Believe in him whom he has sent. The outer frenzy that we witnessed earlier, as the people had sought after this celebrity of sorts from Galilee, it turns inward, as is evident in the sparring that transpires. The NRSV version read today translates from the Greek thusly. So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you?" Eugene Peterson's The Message, which is a modern-day paraphrased version, which I find very interesting and helpful at times, puts their response like this. They waffled. "Why don't you give us a clue about who you are, just a hint of what's going on? When we see what's up, we'll commit ourselves." When Jesus reminds them of the manna given to the Israelites in the wilderness and how much better is the bread on offer, they demand, "Then give us this bread." But when Jesus claims, "I am the bread of life," the passage goes on to say the Jews began to complain because Jesus says this. How dare he make such a claim? And so it goes. And an opportunity for life seems to slip away in translation. The human condition turns the life-giving message into a source of friction and confusion and even contempt. Well, it's in our nature not to trust. And that's a good thing to have when we're out there navigating our way through this world, perhaps. Now, I've never lived in first century Palestine, and I can't imagine what it was like, but I can bet life was pretty precarious for most. So when you're looking for something or someone to align yourself with, you probably didn't have much to fall back on if it all went south. We, on the other hand, live in 21st century Canada. And we are of a different mindset than first century peoples when it comes to considering matters of faith and spirituality. But after all is said and done, and the history of the church for good and bad that affects our consciousness, we are still looking for something or someone trustworthy to align ourselves with. But this Jesus is just as much a mystery and a possible threat to us today as he was when he was traveling about the Judean countryside, perhaps for different reasons. But the question, the underlying question in the human heart has not changed. Am I really worthy of this love God is gifting me with? Can I trust what I don't understand? We know this gift of life Jesus offers is a good gift. When we stop and get quiet and acknowledge the fact that nothing this world has to offer brings a peace and joy that lasts. Our own health, loving relationships, all such things come sometimes, often with strings attached, and they are part of the changes and chances of this life. And such things will come to an end. But when Jesus says to you, "I am the bread of life," Jesus is saying that God sustains and that you are worth sustaining. This kind of love is being offered to us by the God who is willing to die for us. That's just how much the Creator thinks we are worth it, worth dying for. This truth will calm the inner tumult, dispel the mistrust, ease the clamoring and grasping, the frenzied search for magic tricks. Come, taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are they who trust in him.
Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. For all our government leaders as they guide us through this pandemic and distribution of the vaccines. Lord, have mercy. For all doctors, nurses, technicians, frontline and essential workers, and their families for their health and safety. Lord, have mercy. For all the workers and businesses affected by the economic downturn, that the aid promised will get to them in a timely manner. Lord, have mercy. For the homeless and forgotten. Lord, have mercy. For Knight Stable, Regeneration, St. Louis Outreach, and other centers that are trying to meet their needs. Lord, have mercy. For all educators and teachers as they find ways and technologies to teach the students, and for the students and their caregivers. Lord, have mercy. For our clergy and staff as they find ways to do church safely. Lord, have mercy. For all who are sick and their families and caregivers, that they might find strength and perseverance in you. Lord, have mercy. For all those who have died from COVID-19, may their souls rest in peace. We pray for them and all who mourn their loss. Lord, have mercy. For the people in India where the pandemic has overrun the country. Lord, have mercy. For an end to gun violence in our cities. Lord, have mercy. For all persecuted Christians and for International Christian Voice. Lord, have mercy. For those suffering and struggling with mental health illness. Lord, have mercy. For a peaceful resolution to the land claimed by our indigenous people. Lord, have mercy.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to his fellowship. Let us confess our sins then, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and bring you to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. My sisters, my brothers in Christ, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace.
Let us pray. God, our sustainer, accept all we offer you this day and feed us continually with that bread which satisfies all hunger. Your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God of grace, we are members of the body of Christ. May we always live with you forever and ever. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and those you love and serve, this day and always. Amen. Peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.